Good afternoon. I want to welcome you to this celebration of life. We are not here necessarily to have a funeral. We're here to have a celebration of life. And all of you sitting here today that have known Josh in any measure would know that Josh would not want to have a funeral. He would want to have a celebration of life. And so we're here today in this place to do that. And I'm going to begin our time together, first of all, by inviting you to bow your hearts in prayer with me as we open this time together and invite the presence of God in a strong way to come and just to unite our hearts, unite our thoughts, and for us to be able to have as best as possible a good time in His presence. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for life on this earth, on this planet, as You have given us. Father, we are so grateful that You are ultimately in charge of everything. There are times, Lord, when life oftentimes comes with unexpected and sudden surprises. Father, I want to thank You, first of all, for the expanse of the effect that Joshua Aaron Reed had on this planet. I thank You for the global influence. I thank You that what he stood for, Lord, was amazing. I'm asking, Father, that over these next few moments together, as we gather to celebrate his life, Father, that You would come and You would just invade this place with Your presence at a level that comforts every heart and every life, from the family, Lord, to close friends, to those that couldn't be here today that might be live streaming this time together. Would You come into that very room where they're at, and that You would just completely engulf us, Lord, in a place where we can know that what has taken place we will have, may not have understanding of, but we will be comforted in those places that we need comfort, as only Your Holy Spirit can. And so we just commit this time into Your hands, asking that You would be glorified and that You would be honored. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen.
I was just going to explain that a lot of times my husband and I do a lot of teaching and team work, and I know we've been such dear friends of Carla and Joshua, and so she'd asked that if both of us could do this. I'm just praying for strength. But I sang at my own father's funeral, so I'm doing this for Joshua today, and just so honored and blessed that we get this. It's an honor and a privilege. And we were actually on vacation and got the call from Carla. And I'm glad you called us so I didn't read it on Facebook. But quite a shocking thing to hear on vacation, and not quite sure should we run home then, or, you know. But anyway, we made the trip home yesterday. And so we're still... You know, the first time to see Carla was this morning. And then to be able to meet her family, what an awesome... I feel like I know you, some of the grandkids. I was like, well, I know who you are. And they're like, I've never seen you before, but because your grandmother and Josh has spoken of you in our lives so much. And so, you know, you don't like meeting in these circumstances, but really glad to meet you. And very honored that we get this privilege. We take it very deeply. And as John was praying, I heard him saying the global impact. I'm like, a 30-year-old life and yet the impact that he had in those 30 years. We wish there were 60 more years with him. But the short amount of life did not restrict the amount of impact that he had, especially in the family's life, but in all of ours in this room. And I know we could be here for days reminiscing and sharing memories of what it was to know Josh. And so we have to compact it into this afternoon, and then Monday, what a celebration Monday will be as well. But anyway, so like John was saying, this is Carla, especially in the family, they want this to be a celebration of his life. And yes, there's tears, but there's some joy there too. We all have funny stories with Josh and some moments he made us laugh. And so those are really neat things to treasure. So I encourage you to do that. And I know in our own lives, Josh impacted, and our daughter, who couldn't be here today, I know she sends her love, Carla. And he was just at a special time in her life. She needed a listening ear from a person whose mom had been in ministry, and Josh did that for her. And then Bill and Connie Wilson. Bill was already back in Israel. And I don't know if you've heard from him. He was going to try and call you, but right away, oh no, that's my buddy. And we got to be with Connie in Portland this week, but they send their love, and then Kay Byer just so send their love to you. And this young man impacted them greatly. And so it's just such an honor to be able to do this today.
I want to share just a quick passage of scripture, actually, that's written right in your bulletin that you received, out of Psalm 16, in verse 3. And want to start there in our time together. These are the beautiful ones in the land, the excellent and the noble, in whom is all my delight. And right below that, there's three amazing paraphrase of this whole passage of scripture. Joshua, a beautiful soul, a spirit of excellence, and a noble life. It was interesting this morning. I know that, Ruth, you're going to be sharing just a little bit about his name. But one thing that I felt like I heard from God just before the waking hours. You know, sometimes when you hear something that it just is repeated in your heart, and you know it's the voice of God. And this is what I heard about Joshua. Was three different words. Valor. The word valor means great courage in the face of danger. Tell you what, three tours of duty, face of danger, especially in battle. It says that's the part of the definition. Especially in battle, gives a quotation. The medals are awarded for acts of valor, and I know that he has medaled as well, and so for bravery and courage. The second word that God gave me, I heard God give me, was the word integrity. And I know that Joshua had a very integrous heart. His principles, moral uprightness, being honest, having strong moral principles, honesty. You know, it just that's who he was. And then the state, the third one, was the word purpose. So you have valor, you have integrity, and you have purpose. The reason why something is done. In other words, Joshua had intention. Intention, he always had feeling of being determined to do something, achieve something. He had personal goals. Those were all part of what made up Joshua's character. And so I wanted to focus on those three things. I know Ruth has got a couple of things, and then we're going to move on here today in our time together. But I just want to share one story. One story was this. You know, we You'll have to remind me, Carla, because we came over to Carla's apartment for a feed of the little lamb cubes, Chislik. And I couldn't remember the name of that for the life of me, and I've asked you that before. But we were out, it was freezing. I can't even remember what time of year it was, but it was absolutely freezing. So we were at her her apartment, and you know, they allowed us to use the clubhouse barbecue. So we're out there, just he and I, and we're you know, just roasting these cubes of pork and just freeze lamb, right? Lamb, not pork. Just freezing ourselves up. We were so anxious to get back in to, you know, eat these delicacies. We had a great time that day. I'll never forget that day, freezing our backsides off while barbecue and Chislik and just laughing. Just a great time together. So, Ruth, you had a couple things you wanted to share before we...
Well, and then I just, that prompted a memory when we took him to dinner for his birthday a couple years ago. And we kind of wanted to take him to Wolf Lodge or something. No, he wanted to go to Hunter's in Post Falls. I said, okay, Josh, we'll go. And what a sweet time we did have. The Lord just afforded some special moments that way. But I really like to do word studies and all of that. And so I was pondering even this week on the meaning of his names. And, of course, Joshua was one I've been very familiar with most of my life. But Yeshua's salvation. And I thought, there was sacrifice involved. And I thought, Joshua did not back down from sacrifice. And I remember praying over him, especially that last tour of duty. It's a little harder when you really know what you're going to that time. And yet he did not shrink back from that. Remember that day we prayed for him right here in this room, right up here. And he was ready. And we were so proud of him that day. And I was like, wow, I'm so proud of you. That impact that he made in my life that day, just seeing that determination. Not that he was just wanting to go, and you know, because he knew what he was facing, and yet he did that. And Yeshua's salvation, he lived up to his name. And then the name of Aaron, that means the high place or exalted one, high mountain. And of course, Aaron was the first high priest in the Bible. You know, so that was what he carried in his name, this young man. And I believe he carried it beautifully. I believe he carried it with intent. Because I know his mom told him the meaning of his name. He knew what his name meant. It wasn't just, oh, my parents wanted to name me that. He knew the meaning. And then he lived it out. And then, of course, even getting to, both of his names have Hebrew origin. And then he got to go to Israel. And I know that he just loved it there. And the land loved him. And So I just wanted to share from that standpoint, just thinking on those just thoughts about him personally and just what's packaged into a person. And a lot of times, you know, we just, oh, we know people's names, but there's true meaning behind them. And so grateful for this young man that lived out his name. I meant to mention earlier and forgot to, we are videotaping, and there will be times when different camera shots will be taken. Carla had wanted that, so just to let y'all know that that's been approved, and that doesn't always happen at funerals, but or at celebrations of life. But because it is a celebration of his life, this was something that's being done, and so just to give y'all a heads up that it's a good thing. And I know Josh knows how much you like pictures, Carla, so I know he's fine with that.
He's actually, right now, very much alive.
Yeah, just more alive than he's ever been, yeah.
Total different place.
Yeah. Okay. So I get the privilege of reading the obituary. And Joshua Aaron Reed, age 30, of Pullman, Washington, passed away suddenly early in the morning of July 23rd, 2016 in Moses Lake, Washington. He suffered a cardiac arrest at the home of Scott and Evie Reed, who love him dearly. He was born in Freeman, South Dakota. I was telling some of your family, my mother was born in South Dakota, so I kind of, Carla and I have always kind of had this little knitting of the heart about South Dakota. Born in Freeman, South Dakota on April 1st, 1986, Joshua received his A&P, Airframe and Power Plant License, an Associate of Science degree from Big Bend Community College in Moses Lake, Washington in 2004. I remember those days. Joshua entered the U.S. Army in 2005 and served 6 years as an Apache helicopter crew chief mechanic. He served 2 years of duty in Iraq and Afghanistan and was awarded many service medals. He was currently employed as a helicopter mechanic with Metro Aviation as the base mechanic for MedStar in Pullman, Washington. Again, what a noble thing to do. Joshua was single and had a passion for mechanics, airplanes, helicopters, tools, cars, hunting, fishing, video games, and karaoke. And I know even in his own living room, I believe there were even mechanical parts laying around his living room. And I think he just recently finally got a couch to sit on. But his whole life revolved around that kind of thing. He is survived by his mother, Carla M. Reed, Liberty Lake, Washington, and his father, Robert E. Reed. So good to meet you, Robert. Sterling, Colorado, and their children, spouses, nieces, and nephews. His grandmother, Ida Mae Chance, Neely, Nebraska. He was preceded in death by his grandfather, William Chance, and grandparents, Chuck and Eloise Reed. His oldest brother, Stephen Todd Reed, and wife, Stacy of Garrettson, South Dakota. Their four sons, Jordan, Sawyer, Noah, and Eli, and their daughter, Quincy, and husband, Tyrell, and their two sons, James and Tiberius, love that, and Stephen's honorary children, Jasmine Lang and Jordan Jensen. His sister, Anne Michelle Reed Wagner, and husband Daniel of Louisville, Indiana, and their children, Luke, Hannah, Ethan, Joseph, Titus, Silas, and Eliana. You almost make up the whole Bible. That's awesome. Beautiful names. And his brother, Scott Adam Reed, and wife, Evie of Moses Lake, and their children, Harmony, Addison, Clara, and Ava. He gained two additional siblings with Carly Reed and Matthew Reed, children of Robert Reed and Mary Reed. They reside in Rapid City, South Dakota. His 15 nieces and nephews, two grandnephews, reside in South Dakota, Indiana, and Washington, right? And then the honorary pallbearers, I wanted to acknowledge them. I'll acknowledge them right now. Stephen Reed, his brother. Scott Reed, his brother. Addison Reed, here on South Dakota, his nephew. Taylor Chance, his cousin. Noah Reed, his nephew. And Eli Reed, his nephew. And I know they were, you're all honored to be able to serve him in that capacity. And I know he is pleased that you're doing that. At this time, I'd like to invite up Carla to come, and she has some thoughts to share. And so we welcome you up here, Carla. Isn't she an amazing lady? Amazing lady.
Hello, everyone. I want to so thank each of you for coming, and I really want to thank John and Ruth. I want to thank the Gateway Church who are hosting us today so beautifully. And I want to thank Chris Drake, his wife Jennifer. He's made it possible. He sent all of this up for us today. He's been working with live stream. Hello, live streamers. I had so many people across the country say, I wish we could be there, and came up with the idea to do live streams so that people are here with us, even though they're everywhere else. So I so appreciate that. And all of those who've set up, there's wonderful people here today who've brought food. And I want to just thank everyone who has made this day possible for us that we can come and gather. It's amazing, and we're going to be sharing. I'll be sharing several things. I also want to thank the Patriot Riders who are out front. Such an amazing thing to see them there and to walk through that. And the people here from Metro Aviation and MedStar, all the people who've come. I just thank each and every one of you. And we are celebrating Josh's life today. I'm going to be sharing a lot about him, bragging on him, but not in any way do I want to diminish from my other three wonderful, amazing children. And I'd like to introduce my family to you. So first of all, here on the front, Josh's dad, Robert, so he could, if you would just stand up and kind of face everyone, because it's hard to know who's who when we get to funerals like this. So this is Josh's dad, Robert Reed. He's in Colorado. And then our daughter, Ann, who's come in yesterday from Indiana. Our son, oldest son, Stephen Reed. Stephen and his wife, Stacy. Just go ahead and stand and just let everyone know who you are so we can... I didn't tell you that before because I knew you wouldn't want to do it. Okay. And so Eli. Noah. They all get taller every time I see them. We're just kind of like startled. And before I go, let me just go ahead and introduce the other two, and then I want to include some others here. But and then Scott, who will be sharing in a little bit. This is my middle son, so Stephen's the oldest. Scott, middle one, and Josh was the youngest. When we were all still at home, Anne would say to her friends, she said, would say, "I have three brothers, a large, a medium, and a small." So Scott is the medium. And then his beautiful wife, Abby, and their family. We have Harmony, who's the oldest. She's in Moses Lake. We have Addison. He got like this much taller since I saw him last. Even his dad went, "Whoa." And then we have Clara and Ava. And also really happy today to have Elliot and Judy Smith with us. Maybe you could just stand too. Those are Evie's parents. And my name just went blank with the rest of you. So Cindy, I knew I'd do this. And, pardon? Russell, yeah. And Blair. And Blair, yeah. So you'll get to meet those. Those are Evie's parents. And then I am deeply honored today to have my mother, who has come all the way from Nebraska, Neely, Nebraska, Ida Mae Chan. Just in June, she turned 87 years old, and I think it's remarkable she drove out here with my brother, so she is here. And I'm very blessed to have my siblings here. One of my brothers, I have twin brothers, and one of them was able to come, but they had to leave this morning, so they expressed their sorrow that they couldn't be here, but they had pressing other commitments. So I'm the oldest of six, and then the next one would be my twin brothers, but neither of them are here. And then my sister, Lois, who's here from South Dakota. And let's see, then I have my, and her beautiful daughter, Summer. Summer just flew in yesterday from Arizona. You're going to have to help me here. And then my wonderful sister, Brenda. And she's the youngest. I'll just tell you a little bit. I'm going to take some time here because I know you kind of wonder about us, and we're going to have all the time we want. So So I'm the oldest. 2 years later, I had twin brothers. 7 years later, my sister Lois. 13 years later, my sister Brenda. So I actually changed her diapers. And then her husband Jeff. And they graciously came in early already and have been helping all week. And then we all had a surprise about 22 years old after I was born, and that's my baby brother, Gary. And Gary lives in Ely, Nebraska. His friend Meg is here today, also from Ely, and Taylor, who is his youngest, his son. So they are here a long ways. So yeah, we had a lot of spread. We had 22 years between Gary and I, so he always thought I was his other mom, and I probably was. And so when he was born, it was quite confusing for everyone, because my son Stephen is 1 year older than his uncle. So Gary's the nephew and Stephen's the uncle. I mean, wait a minute, did I get that right? Yeah. Okay, I knew I'd need some help. I think I got everyone, didn't I? Oh, did I get Carly? Yeah, I think I said didn't. Oh, I didn't. No, thank you for helping me out here. So this beautiful young woman here, Carly, is the daughter of Robert and Mary Reed and Matthew, who couldn't be here. And we also have two other honorary grandchildren, Stevens, Jasmine and Jordan. And so want to greet them, really glad they're here. So anyway, I think I covered all of that. I'm just, like I say, I want to take my time. I'll be drinking lots of water. I've cried a lot of tears, and I've been pretty dehydrated, and the weather hasn't helped. But I really want to take time for us today. As shocking as this is, and I'll share a little bit about that, that we celebrate and we enjoy this time of just being together. This is Josh's day. This is Josh's day to tell stories on him, tell stories about him. This is a day just to be together, and I'm just going to do my best because I want to just share some things about him for those of you who knew and those of you who didn't know. And I do want to say, people have kept saying to me how well I'm doing. I mean, you're doing so well. And I said, I know. I said, I've got so many people praying for me. I think I'm just floating on the prayers of others, because the grief that has been expressed across the nation is overwhelming. And so I'm just carried. There's a beautiful sustaining grace, and I just feel carried. And so I'm very grateful for that. Well, you know, when I was getting ready to figure out what to wear to the funeral, it's like, well, gosh, you know, everybody wears black. And I, you know, it's just kind of typical. And I had to go digging around. And I thought, well, I want to wear black and white. You know, a number of years ago, I said out loud, I was like, wow, I really like wearing black and white together. And all of a sudden, I knew why. It's the color of piano keys. They go very well together. And then the second thing I realized is it's the color of print in a book. We have the black print and the white space. And you couldn't have the black without the white. And so I realized, and you know, I've teased my family, all of us love books. And I said, how could we not ever love books when our last name is Reed? So I want to say that certainly the shocking news, Josh surprised us all. We're all shocked. Everyone I talked to was stunned and shocked. But you know, he kind of surprised me when he showed up on April Fool's Day. I thought I was going to have a girl. I already had two boys. I had one daughter. We had decided we'd like another girl. And, you know, early in the morning, I woke up in labor and went to the hospital, and I had a boy. But I had a girl's name picked out. So I went home the same day, and due to some things where I had someone looking after me, and anyway, I said, well, I don't know about a name. I was going to have a girl. And so they said, well, I said, but I've got to go home, you know, and they were going to discharge me early. So I said, can I call you tomorrow with a name? They said, well, we've never sent a baby home without a name. I said, well, I'll promise to call you tomorrow. And they said, okay. And so, of course, that night, being with him, I knew his name, Joshua Aaron. And it's been the perfect name. Again, there's a lot of spread in our family, so Stephen being the oldest. And then 5 years after Stephen was born, we had our daughter, Anne. And 2 years after that, our son, Scott. And then 9 years after that, Joshua was our surprise baby on April Fool's Day. And so there's a 16-year spread. So a lot of people who've known me and known Josh think I only have one. They're quite shocked when they find out I have 4 children, and they're really shocked when they find out I have 15 grandchildren out of the 3 here, and also 2 great-grandchildren now. So I'm very, very blessed with that. You know, when Josh was little, he would already amaze us. When he was like 2, he loved puzzles. In fact, I would buy puzzles that were advanced, like for 4- and 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds, and he just loved a puzzle immediately. And let me stop for a drink here. So he had a mechanical mind from the get-go. In other words, how do things go together was something he was exploring like at 2 and 3. The other thing is he loved Legos. So especially Technique Legos as it got more advanced. He had the regular Legos and then he loved the Technique Legos, which were those really tiny little pieces that you don't want to step on. And so one time when he was about 12, we bought several Lego sets, because the minute he got a Lego set, he had to get to the instructions and he had to put it together. He never wasted any time putting Legos together. So in about 1998, he was about 12 years old, and we were in Minneapolis, and we had an opportunity to go to the Mall of America. And so when we did, they have a Lego store there, a huge Lego store. And so when we got there, he was in Lego heaven, because every time he'd get a new set of Legos, he would go through the catalog and he would pick out the ones he wanted next. And for quite a while, he had his eye on a huge set that was the Space Shuttle Columbia. Very complicated. In fact, there are some pictures out there of him grinning, having put that thing together. So we were walking through the store, and I knew he'd seen it, and I knew he wanted it. But it was about $200 to $250. That's a lot for a Lego set. But I watched him walk around and choose something he thought I might buy for him. Something cheaper, something less, something he settled for, but it wasn't really what he wanted. And all of a sudden, there was an indignity, like, why can't I get him what he wants? So he came to me with something and he said, this is, how about this one, Mom? I said, but I thought you wanted the space shuttle. He says, well, I do. And I said, well, don't you think we should get it? The look on his face was, well, yeah. He says, we'll go pick it up. We're going to get it. So on the way home, driving back to South Dakota that time, he was sitting in the passenger seat next to me, 12 years old. And he looked over at me and he said, you know, Mom, now I know you really love me. I could never hear him say that without crying. Now I know you really love me. Amazing. And you know what? When we got home, that whole thing came out of the box, the parts and the parts and the parts and the parts. And within about 3 days, he had it done. He didn't stop until it was finished. He loved Legos. In fact, at Christmas time when the Star Wars movie came out, he decided he was going to buy him one of those fighters. Couldn't keep up. It was that big one. It was a huge set, Technique set. I think cost him $300 or more, and he was so excited. He was like a little kid at Christmas getting more Legos. So we said, Mom, this will be a collector's item. And so he bought that set. And he went to work immediately. By the time I got there to go see him after, you know, he already had it done. In fact, when we went to his apartment, I knew he'd have bought another one. But he had four of those things, and every one of them were assembled, sitting around decorating his space. He still loved Legos. And that meant a lot. We're going to keep them because we'll never get them back together. We'll keep them all the way they are. At a young age, Josh showed amazing musical ability. And I was in a chorale of singers, and I would go to practice, and he'd be about, 4 years old. And I'd hear him suddenly singing my songs on key. And I went, oh my gosh, here he is just singing, and he's got pitch and everything. And I'd start something and he'd finish it. So a friend of ours had a daughter who was taking violin lessons in about fifth grade. And she told me about, you know, how they train them through ear training. And so I decided to investigate that. They said, yeah, we'll take them as young as 2 and 3 years old. And so as it turned out, we were able to rent a little violin. Believe it or not, the one you see out there, he had one smaller than that. It's out on display there with that beautiful picture. So he just took to it like a duck to water because he just knew where it needed to go. It was just, nobody had ever played violin in our family, but he just did amazing with it. And by the time he was 7 going on 8, which is the beautiful picture you'll see out there in the lobby, he had advanced to a second book, and he did an entire recital, 12 songs from memory, in Mitchell, South Dakota, and he did it all on that little violin. I mean, it's not the best sound when you get one that little, but the skill level was astonishing for just shy of 8 years old. And that's the picture from the recital and what he did there. He was very poised. The instructor who had a lot of different kinds of students says he's a natural performer. You know, eventually that kind of got pushed to the back, and he took up tools, and he took up guns, and he took up other kinds of things. But that skill level that he had and that ability to move his fingers, I believe, is what created that amazing mind of his, that he could put things together, take them apart, put them together. He really couldn't be with us too long without finding something to take apart and put together. In fact, he couldn't sit in my chair across from me without taking my pens apart. The pens, you know, like you write with the pen. I had them stuck in a little cup there, and he would just pull one out and unscrew it and pull the spring out and then kind of put it back in. And I'd say, leave my pens alone, because he just couldn't keep his hands still. He had to be taking something apart. We played for a number of weddings and got some beautiful pictures of that, but very, very gracious, very, very amazing. And then eventually, we traveled. Josh and I traveled for about 3 years together. I was involved with some ministry work and some music. And he would be with me. And we actually crossed the nation several times traveling. At about 5 years old, 6 years old, or I'm sorry, fifth grade, sixth grade, I had an opportunity to do that. He was the last one at home. So I decided, why not? And he was very, very happy about homeschooling because he didn't have to do that anymore, go to school somewhere. And we started traveling across the country. He and I together went to 42 states. And so that's why there was such a depth to him. And he was so good at adapting to people, just like he could be with this kind of people and we travel somewhere else, he could be with that kind of people. And he was just amazing, his ability. He could be with grown-ups and talk grown-up language, and he could go down and he could play with little kids. So it made him very personable. And then, as we were traveling, he had always loved airplanes, always. From the time he was little, he loved airplanes, made paper airplanes, all of that. But one time he said to me, we had an Encyclopedia Britannicas, which are kind of pretty rare anymore, but he said to me, you know my favorite one? I said, no. He said, it's A. I said, why is it A? He says, because it's got airplanes in it. We still have that set. I gave it to him. I'm going to get them back. So, but that's how, and so then about at age 16, I'll never forget this. We had been trying to homeschool, hit and miss here, things doing here. But we, every time we traveled, we took in every national monument. We took up every state park. We made learning, traveling, learning a part of what we did. I remember when we went to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and we learned there about the Civil War. So there was just so much that happened in our time. I look back and, you know, at times it was difficult because you get juggled around, but on other times we had amazing opportunity to be together. And that's why we became very close. You know, we'd have just tease me and we just got along really well. So in about 16 years of age, I said, well, you know, you can now take your pretest. And I was like, oh my gosh, I wonder where we're at. You know, what's going to happen? How's he, you know, how far behind are we? That kind of thing. So we arranged for him to take a pretest at 16. And I was someplace else at the moment. And he came to where I was and he slid in beside me, kind of sitting there. And he gave me a really funny look. And I thought, oh, brace yourself, you know. And then he kind of grinned at me, says, well, he said, I passed every one of them, got them all almost perfect. And I went, what? And so the people said, well, you go ahead and take your GED. And so within a month, he got it and whizzed right through it. So that was the kind of mind, he just was always thinking, he was always sharp. And so at that point, he wanted to be a pilot. He knew that early on, and he wanted to be a mechanic. He figured it would be smart to know how they work before you got in one. So at that point, we started to check out schools, other parts of the country. I came out to Washington. This would have been about the summer of 2002. And we had heard that they had an excellent program in Moses Lake at Big Bend. And so we stopped to check it out. Like I say, he was not very much over 16. And to our amazement, they would take him at 16, and he could start in about 6 weeks. So that was the draw for us to come out here, because I had already fallen in love with Washington, and that was fine with me. But for any of you who have ever been to Moses Lake, you know that was not necessarily what I had in mind for Washington State. So that fall of 2002, he entered the program. I believe he was the youngest to ever enter. And had wonderful instructors there. He had 5 quarters. And within the 5 quarters, as fast as he could go, he went through them. After every quarter, he took his FAA test, passed it. And so that 15-month program, he completed just shy of his 18th birthday. And they said, well, we can't give you your A&P license because you've got to be 18 to get it. So they wouldn't sign it for him, but everything was completed. And so we had a big birthday party for him, and on his 18th birthday, they signed his A&P license. Pretty remarkable. I think it surprised everyone there. And so at that time, then he began kind of wondering what to do. He decided to go back, kind of took a couple courses, ended up with an Associate of Science degree. And then he was restless. You know, there was a lot about the military that drew him. He thought about the Air Force, but the Army kind of began to speak to him, gave him a wonderful offer, and he loved helicopters as well. So by the February of 2005, he decided he was going to join the military. He came up to Spokane to take a test, and other than the other morning when Scott had to call me with the news that Josh had passed, that awful, awful feeling that a mother gets happened when he said, I just joined the Army for 6 years. I have to go 6 years to get the training I want. And it was the most awful sinking feeling, because the time was up and you knew. But he again excelled in what he did. Say one more thing, I'm kind of winding down here, but when on his April 1st, 2004, he would have been 18, That was also the day that I bought my van. I have a Honda Odyssey that sitting out here, 2004. And so we picked up the van the same day, pretty much, or the day before. Because I loved to drive and I traveled, I put a lot of miles on those van. You'll be shocked when I tell you. But Josh recently just fixed me all up again. In fact, in October last year, I turned 300,000 miles on that van. And I said, I don't know what to do. I don't know if I should get something different. I don't know what to do. And sometime after the first of the year, we were standing in my kitchen, and he said, well, Mom, you've taken such good care of it. He said, I can fix it. I said, because I'd gotten an estimate from Honda, and they said, oh, it's going to be this, oh, this is wrong, need this, and this, and it was going to be like $2,000, $3,000 maybe. And so he said, I can do the work. He said, you know, I have to take it apart. And so we thought about that and arranged, and so I said, okay, well, we got on Amazon and bought parts for $500. He knew exactly what I needed, and he took over. I could always count on him. He couldn't even, you know, if he was there, he would polish my headlights because they get dirty, and then he'd get under the hood and he'd look and check things. He was always under there kind of checking belts and putting things together. But in March, or I guess it was late March, early April, he worked on my van, and he says, yeah, Mom, you could probably get another couple hundred thousand miles on it. So I said, I'm going to go for it. But Alex is here. He's the... would you mind standing just for a minute so everyone knows who you are? We just met him this morning, this wonderful gentleman from Pullman, who's the director operator of the Pullman Moscow Airport. But we were allowed to pull it in and work on it. And so I'm good for some more miles, except for that little rattle underneath that he could never figure out. That was his next project. What's that rattle under there? So anyway, he's kept me running. So see what else I have here. Josh was single. He'd never married. And I always started to feel like maybe that was my fault. When we were traveling and he was 14, 15, and 16, he would complain to me. He'd say, why do you have so many shoes? I'd say, well, that's what women do. I'm just getting you ready to get married. And then he'd say to me, why does it take you so long to get ready? And I'd say, well, that's what women do. When you get married, women take a while to get ready. And then he'd say, why did you park in that spot? In fact, about 10 days ago on that Wednesday, I was deeply grateful looking back that he had some time off and he was able to come up to Liberty Lake for the day. I was going to go down there because he said, Mom, I got a new couch. I said, finally, you've been down there 4 years. So I was going to go down and see his couch. And then he called, well, I got some time off. I just soon get out of town here. And I said, well, come on up. And so he said, where do you want to go? And I said, well, we got a new Cracker Barrel in Coeur d'Alene. Let's go there. He said, okay. So we stepped out and he says, well, are you going to drive or you want me to drive? He has a little, I think it's an Audi sports car. I don't remember the exact thing of it, but... he loves that little black car. I don't, because it's hard to get in and out of. But I said, why don't you drive? Then I can critique your driving. You drive. Okay, so he'd laugh every time I got in, and he'd laugh every time I got out. And we made several stops that day. We went to Cracker Barrel, and looking back, there was a moment when we were waiting there, and... The waitress was taking our orders, and he looked up, and there was something in his eyes that took my breath away, like you see the essence of who someone is. And it was so startling in that moment. He just looked up, like ready to, you know, get the order. You think about a lot of things after they happen. And so then we went to a couple other places. I'm so grateful again for this gift. We went to the Cabela's, his very favorite place. I bought him a gift certificate for his birthday. We hadn't spent it. He didn't even spend it that day, so now I get to. And then we went to the mall. We went to Barnes & Noble, just looked around. He came back. We sat for a long time where he shared kind of the changes that were happening at work. He didn't know quite what to do. He was very unsettled, agitated about some of it. Just, you know, maybe it's time for me to make some changes. I said, well, let's think about this. Let's talk about that. And when he left, he gave me his famous hug. And I would have never thought that would be the last one. But he drove that day. And then I got to, we went to the mall and I said, well, why are you parking there? The other thing he'd say to me, like I say, that's probably my fault, he never got married, he'd say, why do you put all that stuff on your face? I said, well, that's what women do. They like to put lotion on and whatever else. And so when he'd stay with me, I had some lotion I put on before I went to bed, and I'd always say, do you want a hug before I put it on or afterwards? Because every once in a while I'd put it on and just go smearing good, and no, before. And so we kind of decide on that. The other thing he'd say to me is, why do you have to take so much stuff? I've got mine in this little bitty thing and you've got suitcases. So those were the kinds of things that we kind of laughed about. Like I say, eventually I thought, gosh, maybe it's my fault he didn't get married. Okay. Well, one other thing, I'm just about done here, I think. Like I say, he loved buttermilk pancakes. That was my mom's recipe, come up. And I want to say this, when he came back from the military, Josh had a very tender heart, and the military toughens people up in a way, changes them. And when he came back a very changed young man after 6 years. I knew it was going to happen. I could see it. But he came back to a changed mom. After 6 years, and the reason he came here was basically was based in Fort Bragg, North Carolina, and he'd been out here. He liked the area. And he didn't know what else to do at that point, so when he came back, he came back different. And it's odd, because when he did, it was like we had to get to know each other all over again. It's like, who's this person? And for me, and you don't relate on the same place. But we had the most amazing relationship, became friends. I'd say sometimes, you're like one of my best friends, you know, or my best friend. We just had wonderful times of just talking, but it was at a whole different place that could happen. One of the things that we liked doing together was watching movies. When he came back out of the military, he liked the series Stargate. He liked Star Wars, but he liked Stargate. He had bought the entire 10-year season on a DVD. DVDs, and he took them to Afghanistan with him, so when he did his work, he could go back to his barracks or his little cubicle, and he would just go through the Stargate and get lost in space somewhere. And that was, so when he came back, he told me about them, and I found that during that time, it was very healing for us as I engaged with what he loved, and spaceships, and the whole thing with Stargate. We watched all of them. The other thing Josh would do when he came is he always knew to expect a honey-do list. And so I would have things on there, like, I've got this or I've got that. He always knew that I'd want him to sharpen my knives. In fact, last time he showed up with his strap, and I didn't even have to ask him. He just went ahead and did it. If I had computer problems, he just, again, had a knack for fixing things. So, you know, when children are born, a mom knows some things. We get to know our children, and you know, we know them as babes, we know them as toddlers. Some great pictures out there. You watch the development, and then we know a lot of things, but we never know pain, like the pain I have felt this week. And again, there's a grace that has allowed me to stand here and share his life. I want to hear from the others here in a moment, and my children are going to share. But it is, it's a knowing that you can't know until you know it. And so I want to open this up, first of all, to my family to come up and share their experiences. And if any of us think of something else where we can come up, and I know my son Scott for sure will start that out. And then I want to open, after family's done some sharing, I'd like it to open this up, an open mic. I assume we'll come up here because we are recording and we are live streaming. It's not as scary up here as it looks, really. A lot of good people here. But the people who he's worked with, I'd love to hear from you. I'd like to hear the stories. You know, I don't think Josh would want us crying over him today as much as we cry. I think he would like to know how he touched our lives. I will say this, as we traveled all over the country, that when I put it on Facebook and I've sent out some emails, I will just tell you this, he has upset everybody in the country. They are shocked, they're grieving, they're stunned. So we're upset here, but he has left a huge legacy of lives he has touched. And then after some MedStar people or some Metro people have shared, I would like to open it to others. And they'll be moving a mic around. And I just want to hear what you have to say. That's what we're doing today. And we're going to get this again, capture it for the people who couldn't come. And I think that's the best way today to honor this young man's life who's touched us all so much. So at that this time, I think, turn it back to you, Pastor John, here for just a moment. And I love this couple. They've been very dear friends for a long time. And when Josh would go into the on a tour of duty, they'd just kind of pray for him. And every time we had a little, you know, little prayer request list, he'd be up there. And I'm very deeply honored that they've been able to come back and be here. Just came in last night. So let's share and let's laugh. We'll cry, but I want to hear from the rest of you. Thank you.